Arindam, hi. First of all, thank you so much for doing this interview with us. Being for the foreigners, you know, the standard of the league, there isn't a better man to ask than Mr. Arindam himself, the man who's won the title, the man who's seen this league. I mean, I think from the very beginning, you've been around. So what kind of feedback have you given them? Have you told them how difficult it actually is?
I'm telling them everything, you know. I'm telling them it's going to be hectic and end of the league. Last probably final phase of the league, it's not going to be easy mentally also, because you will be trained and tired, you want to be going home and things like that. But the only way we can get success is we have to work as a team, and we have to be very close, and we have to enjoy ourselves as much as we can inside the bubble. I've explained them all that, because otherwise it's going to be very difficult. It'll be long 5 months otherwise. So they know everything, they have an idea of the league, the quality which comes in the league. So they have an idea and they know where they have to perform, what level they have to play the football in, what's going to be the temperature, the ground sizes, the travel, you know, the food and all the things they know. I'm giving them all the information I can. Obviously, again, we have a very good coach. Coach is helping us a lot in terms of the league and all. He has worked with a very good footballers, top academy in Spain. Obviously, we all know that. So he's going to be big help for the junior and senior players also. And we are already feeling that. So yeah, overall, I think we are gelling well, and we're going to be doing good when the league starts, because we are preparing well. And all the foreigners, they are very positive and energetic, and we have worked very hard during the first phase of pre-season. So we are very confident and positive about the season. Yeah.
Fantastic. And talk us about your move from, you know, ATK Mohun Bagan to SC East Bengal. Must have been quite it's almost like, you know, switching between two rival clubs, of course. So how was that move for you, and what were your thoughts like, you know, ahead of this? There's a lot of talk about, a lot of chatter around your transfer. Everyone's like, he's going here, he's going there. I think you were really linked to Chennai FC at one point. A lot of links, a lot of rumors, and then we see you at SC East Bengal. So talk us through those, through that phase, perhaps.
See, after I left Mohun Bagan, it was very late. I didn't have too many options to move to, and all the teams had their goalkeepers set. So it's always a difficult move that late. But I had 2-3 options, and I was just taking my time, because I knew I had time. I could sign even one day before the league starts, you know, because I was a free player. So I was just taking my time, and I was wanting to know what's going to happen, and, you know, where I'm going and what are their objectives as a team, as a club. So that's why I was taking a little time, and even till the last minute, I didn't know where I'm going to join. But since my family back home, everyone is East Bengal, it motivated me a little bit. But again, saying that, I met Srenik Seth, and he motivated me to I asked him what are the objectives. They said they want to win, and they are making a good team. And obviously, that helped a lot. And again, knowing that my senior, Renadi Singh, is there in AC East Bengal as an assistant coach, that's going to be a big help as well. I knew that. And I think both these three factors helped me to choose East Bengal, because first my family, then I spoke to Srenik Seth, and he sounded really motivated to do good as a team. And obviously, I didn't speak to Renu Bhai, because he's my senior and we don't talk much, but I know him as a guy, and I know he'll be a big help for the Indian players, and obviously I could learn a lot from him. So these are the three factors. I chose East Bengal, and it was a last minute decision, but I'm glad I took the right decision. Yeah.
Well, Arindam, there was a bit of confusion, right? There was a bit of uncertainty over whether they would play in the ISL this season or not. And then there was a consensus that was reached towards the end. But did that at any point, was that a confusing phase where you had to figure out, you know, how do you proceed with that?
Not really. All that didn't bother me, because anyway, I wanted to sign for a year. So whatever is happening with East Bengal, it's all backroom thing. My job was to play football, you know. So I was not concerned about that at all, because anyway, I'm not going to be, you know, I was not planning to sign for 3, 4 years or 10 years. I just wanted to sign for 1 year and try and do a good job, and then see where I stand as a goalkeeper the following year. So that was the plan. And what was happening with East Bengal didn't really bother me much. Yeah.
Arindam, what part of the objective or the plan was it that impressed you? In the sense that, you know, you said you are involved with Srenik as well, with regards to the club's objective and the plan ahead. What part of it was that stood out for you and made you want to sign for the club?
I don't know the plan, if they want to win it, or they just want to have a team and compete. And what Srenik sir told me, they really want to win it, and they're making a team to win it with whatever options they're getting. And he promised me they're getting good foreigners, and he kept his promise. We have a very good bunch of foreign players and perfect mixture of senior and junior Indian players also. So that's what, when I spoke to him, he sounded ambitious, and that's what motivated me. And again, as I said, my family and all the background history of East Bengal and Renu Bhai being there, played their part two. But yeah, after speaking to Srenik sir, that's what I understood, that he wants to win. And obviously, when someone wants to win, they'll put a lot of effort, and which makes the job easy, you know.
But tell us about your family. I'm sure they also would have gunned for you to join East Bengal. So what was that like? Were they completely against you joining any other club? Was it always going to be East Bengal?
Try to motivate me to play for East Bengal as such, even before. But I know my dad is no more, my grandfather is no more, but I know they had they were all big East Bengal supporters, so I know that. And my uncle is also East Bengal supporter, so I know the fact that they're at back home, everyone is East Bengal supporter. So I spoke to my uncle. They were telling me, see, if you want to sign East Bengal, just consider it. And all the things were happening, you know, typical Bengali family, so that was there. But then obviously, I wanted to know what East Bengal want to do as a team. So finally, when this thing happened and I got to meet Srenik sir, you know, I knew where I have to go and what I have to do. So, yeah.
But growing up, did their fandom for East Bengal also rub off on you? Were you also like a fan of East Bengal growing up?
Before I started playing football, I was a little bit East Bengal fan as a kid. But when I started playing professionally, I was neutral always, you know, because I was neither playing for East Bengal or Mohunbagan back then. I was playing for Churchill, and I was playing against East Bengal Mohunbagan every year. As a professional, I was neutral. I never felt anything like that, because I was always feel for my club, obviously, for obvious reasons. But now I'm feeling like I'm home. After signing for East Bengal, I feel I'm home. Yeah.
Fantastic. And talk us through your footballing journey. I think you've perhaps played in almost all the footballing hotbeds of the country. And it began at the TFA, and now we're at SC East Bengal. Talk us through the journey of your career. What would you say, you know? How do you think your career has shaped up so far, in your own words?
I used to play cricket back in the days as a play cricket. And then I used to play football too. We had the seasons for every sport back home in Calcutta, from where I belong. So during the winters, we used to play cricket, and during the rains, obviously, we used to play football. So one of my friend, he was a left back. He used to play for the district team. We used to play bare feet, but this guy then took me, you want to play as a goalkeeper, because our coach is looking for a goalkeeper, and I used to play as a goalkeeper in our village team. So he took me there. Then I met the goalkeeper coach, and he told me, you can do good, you are tall. And then I started training, and then I went to Sai. You know, Sai Calcutta for trials, and then I got picked there at Sai. Then I started playing for Sai, and I was playing for my village team as well. And then after 2 years, I think I went to Tata Football Academy for a trial, and I got picked, and I was there for 2 years. And I played under 19 Indian team and under 23 Indian team while I was at Tata Football Academy, and we had one second division I League as a TFA. Batch for the first time, Tata Football Academy won the second division I League, and we had actually qualified for the I League back then. This is 2005-06, I think. So then I got convocated, and I had a few options in Calcutta as well, and other teams like Punjab and Goa. But I chose to go to Churchill because I met Churchill Alemão in Bangalore while I was playing the second division I League, and I decided to join Churchill, and then I was there for 6-7 years straight while I was playing for the senior national team, and won almost all the trophies for Churchill at a very young age. Yeah, I won my I League in 19, so all that thing happened, only that I didn't win the Fed Cup then, and I had a move to Mohunbagan for a year, and again then I came back to Churchill, long story. So then I won the Fed Cup, and then I completed the trophies in India after winning the Fed Cup, and then ISL came in. I started playing for Pune, and then you know, that's my journey.
But what kind of difference do you see in the two leagues, the I League back in the day and the ISL of today? what sort of a difference do you see as a goalkeeper in terms of the game style of play as well as the quality of play? What sort of difference do you see?
So I-League was good, but ISL is a little more professional. I mean, for me personally, I got a better coach and good goalkeeping coach in ISL, which I never got to experience during my I-League days. So that is one thing I would say, and better ground qualities and all, you know, is there in ISL, so which helped me personally, and I'm sure it helps every professional, but I-League days were also good, you know, because if there was no I-League, then we wouldn't have any tournament back then. But yeah, ISL, the quality is better and the approach is very professional. We get good coaches, good facilities, good ground to train with. And for us goalkeepers, we have very good goalkeeper coaches, because in I-League days, I don't remember we had very good goalkeeping coaches back then to learn, you know, as a young kid. I'm learning more now as a senior player than I learned as a young upcoming goalkeeper playing I-League. So for me, I think it's difficult to choose because I love both. If no I-League, I wouldn't have been playing ISL anyway, but I think ISL is much more organized and, you know, helping the players in terms of professionalism and a lot of things in terms of quality also.
And Arnab, like you said, you have access to better coaches here in the ISL. Was there something that you actually had an issue, like a struggle with growing up in the ILA? Because I'm sure at that point, goalkeeping wasn't considered such a key position. It was always focused on strikers and midfielders and defenders. Goalkeeping was just like, haan, keeping kar lega. It wasn't really like given importance as such. Ki you had a dedicated coach for a keeper. So how difficult was it to learn things by yourself or just, you know, adapt to situations?
We used to go to the national team. Luckily, the senior national team, and there we had a good coach. We had Marcos Pacheco. So there we used to get some training and we used to try and follow that during our I-League days. And my batchmate Lalit Thapa, and we used to train together. So we used to go to the beach in the evening and do some diving, some gripping, or go to the pitch again and do a little more training in terms of diving and pitching. But we had no one to push us, you know. And we didn't know what to train before the games and what to train after the game. So once a week, you have to push really hard, but you can't push really hard throughout the week during the season. You know, all that thing, small details we had no clue about, but we used to work. We used to work very hard, but we had no clue if we are doing it right or wrong. But we used to do whatever we know, or some small video of training if you could manage to get in YouTube of Neuer or Buffon. So we used to try and do that in training. So that's how we managed. But we wanted to train, but we didn't have a proper good training because, as you said, it was right. I'm sure a few clubs had goalkeeper coach back then, but where I was playing, we didn't have a very good goalkeeper coach. But I think we didn't learn a lot of things, or we learned a lot of things really late because of that. But one good thing we had, that we wanted to work. So that's why we managed somehow, you know, we did something to stay fit and manage the season. And I think if you look back in the days, we did decent job. It's just that technically we were not very sharp because we were never told the technical aspects of the game because we didn't have a coach. But yeah, we managed somehow. Yeah.
You know, they say there's a saying that being a goalkeeper is a lonely job because you only have the sticks to talk to most of the time. The team is attacking, the entire team is up ahead. So you're left behind, you essentially talk to your sticks. So how is that? Talk us through the journey of the point of view of a goalkeeper. How do you see games? How do you stay in the moment in a match like that?
Before football was different, as I said, during the I-League days, the goalkeeper used to be in the post and the defense is up and we don't have to maintain our back line, you know, the distances and all that. But now football is different. Now we don't have time to do anything. Now there's no talking to the post or anything. We have to constantly be on our toes, maintain the line, the body shape. You have to maintain your shoulders because we had coaches who will have a camera focused on you and he'll show you everything throughout the 90 minutes when you're one less ahead and one less behind, closer to the goal. So 90 minutes, you have to be in right position and with the right shoulder shape. So now there's no time. Now the football is changing and it needs a lot of concentration for us goalkeepers. So now it's different. Now we don't get to talk to the post, but before it was different. Yeah, before, obviously, some of the games we used to talk to the post. So now after the games, we don't get sleep because we need a lot of high concentration. So physically, we are not that tired, but mentally, we are trained, you know, unlike the training days, physically, we are very tired. But now during the games, it's different level of concentration throughout the 90 minutes, which goes in. So it's different now. It's changed. The football is changed in India and changed for good. Yeah.
I'm sure the amount of yelling you do from the post also must take away on your throat after every match.
Some games. Some derbies, yes. But that helps me again to be in the game. As I said, I'm a little loud during the game. I'm a little rough. But sometimes, you know, when your defense is tired and they don't want to do the job, or they want to do the job, but physically they're not able. So, you know, a big shout, a loud shout really helps them to, you know, get it done. And eventually, once we get the result and we go back to the hotel tired, but we have the joy of getting the 3 points and get the job done. We go tired, yes, but we have the joy of bagging. A little shout helps a lot, especially to the defenders during the late in the games, you know.
Absolutely. But, you know, this is a very interesting conversation. I want to take this forward by asking you, how has, you think, goalkeepers evolved since the time you've started? I think since, let's say, last 16 years of your career, you began in 2005 roughly and 2021 now. How do you think it's evolved? Because now we see a few youngsters like Mohammad Nawaz, and then we've also got, forget his name, got a couple of really good young keepers. How do you think this, Dheeraj and Nawaz, of course, the two youngsters we have right now. How do you think this, they're, you know, how has things changed over the last 1.5 decades?
If I have to be honest, I was not half as talented as they are now, because I was not very talented. And they do a lot of things I think I couldn't do at that age, because of the training they are getting and because of the exposure they are getting. And I'm very happy that football is changing for good. So that's what I'm saying. Football was different back then, but now technically they are very sharp. You know, they're competing in the top level and they're technically very sharp. The things which I learned after finishing half of my playing career, and they have learned as kids, you know, when they were preparing for the Under-17 World Cup. So I'm sure it will help them. And when they become coach eventually, they can give it to the next batch, you know, a lot of other kids. So football is changed for good. And technically nowadays, goalkeepers are sharper. Even the young kids, they know what to do. They know how to deal with the ball. They know the positioning. They know the body position. They know they have to be on their feet for a little longer, maybe half a second. And they take steps towards the ball and they don't dive it from, you know, they don't dive from there where they're standing and try to make a save to make it look good for the gallery. But they actually do the right job. Like, all the small details, outside people won't understand, but goalkeeper coaches, they know, and us goalkeepers, we know they're doing the right things, you know, they're going diagonally, all the small details they are doing perfectly, which we had no clue about as kids at their age. But I think it's very good to see that young goalkeepers, they are doing a lot of right things. And by the time they are old in their career and they have done 10, 15 years in Indian football, they'll be so good, you know, because doing this over the years and years, they'll have a lot of experience and probably they'll make a lot of saves look easy because of this technique they have already caught since kids, you know. So, yeah, football has changed for good. And I think now goalkeepers are far more talented and they know to play with pressure, which we didn't have too much back then as kids.
But do you also think the emergence of these young goalkeepers has also created mindset change among coaches? Because as far as I've noticed over the last, I think, about a decade and a half, coaches prefer the more senior and experienced goalkeepers as opposed to a younger one. Whereas a striker, if you see, they put in a young striker saying, okay, look, he can probably score a goal for us, get a 2. But it doesn't work that way with goalkeepers, right? It doesn't really work. He has to take a goal, chhod aaj. It doesn't work that way. You think there's like a small paradigm shift now that maybe you can trust younger keepers as well, give them more game time and put them in pressure situations?
Obviously, the younger ones also have to play, because you can train as hard as you want, but you have to play games, you know, to get the games, because you can't replace anything with games. You can train, as I said, you can train as hard as you can. So I think the younger ones need to play as well. But at the same time, if you have a senior keeper who has the experience, you have to outclass him in something at least, you know, because he has the experience. You have to train harder than him. You have to have better body language than him. Or you have to do something which the senior one can't do, you know, to get the chance in the team. And nothing comes for as a gift. So the junior ones also have to work a little hard on some aspect which the senior one can't do, because he already has the experience. Imagine a senior has done 400, 500 games and the junior doesn't have that. And goalkeeper is a very secured position. There's only one goalkeeper who's going to play. There's no change in 60 minutes, 70 minutes. So the senior one has to understand that he has to give coach something which the senior one can't give. So that's what it is. And you have to compete, but also saying that I want the junior ones to play, and they have to at least choose the teams wisely, I would say, and see the, he has to evaluate where he can go and get some game time, and not only money, a little bit of money and a little bit of game, or maybe a little bit of money and a lot of games, rather than, you know, a lot of money and no game. It's now in Indian football, there's a thing that junior players are not playing in this club, that club, they don't play junior players. But you have to see, the clubs can only offer the players, you know. It's the players who decide to go to the club after they get the offer with big money or something. But I think it's a lot to do with their agents also. They're not educated properly, but sometimes you have to evaluate that, okay, how many games I can play in this club? I have to compete with these guys to play, get games, you know. Okay, there's little less money in some, but I know I'll get 20 games a season, which will obviously, I'll get better with age and I can claim that big money. But for that, I need to get those 60 games in 3 years or 70 games in 3 years to gain that experience, because you can't buy experience with money. You have to spend those days to get the experience. So saying that, obviously, yeah, I would want the junior ones to play, but they have to compete with the senior ones. And the goalkeeper is a very difficult position. Unlike the strikers and all, you can go in late 30 minutes and like 10 minutes remaining and you can score goals. But that doesn't happen with the goalkeepers. You know, you're either in or you're out.
That's
so,
what I was going to ask you. That's exactly my next question, which was, as a striker or as an outfield player, you have an option of playing 10 minutes and still impressing your coach. But as a keeper, you don't get subbed in, because the keepers, if you've considered five goals, doesn't mean you get subbed off and someone else comes in. You don't get replaced that quickly. So then, like, as a goalkeeper, don't you think that as a, the few chances that you do get, in those chances, you have to make an impact? Because agar nahi ho, then matters will not be considered for the next few games. So every game is like a do-or-die for you, right, essentially.
I don't see that way. It's just that when you sign a team, you have to know the other players and you have to evaluate if you, what you think that you can play, you can compete with this guy or not. And then you have to go and actually compete, you know. And if you're not getting a chance, you have to wait for your chance. At least that's what I do. When I there were times I didn't play. I didn't play for 2 years, but I used to be very competitive as I can in training. I used to work very hard on things which I didn't, I was not very good enough, and I was waiting for my chance, you know, because honestly, there's nothing much you can do. You have to just be happy in your head, because after you go in, you have to do a good job, you know. It doesn't make sense being sad and not working good enough, and then you go in and you don't get to do a good job, and your teammates, they're not happy about it, because they'll be like, you were grumpy throughout the season, and when you went in, you couldn't do a good job. So it's just that when you sign a club, you have to be very smart and see how much chance you can get, and then you work hard. If you don't get a chance, then keep working hard and prepare yourself for the next season. They say the money we are getting this season, we have worked for it last season. We have earned it. Actually, we have earned it last season. So the money you're going to make next season, or the performance you're going to do next season, you have to work for it now, this season, you know, this year. So I'll play how good I have worked last season. If I was getting fat and putting on weight, this season can't be good. There's no rocket science. You have to put the effort and put the work in to play well. So if you don't want to waste the time and work hard to have a good season next year, that's what it is when you're not playing. But when you're playing, you have to keep playing. And I think that's what you have to evaluate and see when you're playing or not. But it's a very difficult situation for goalkeepers. But we know the situation, and that's what we have chosen the position to play as a goalkeeper. I think all the goalkeepers are mentally very strong. They know how it is, how the situation is. They know they have to work and the importance of working. And I think at least the Indian goalkeepers who I know, they are all matured in this. You know, even the young ones, they are very mature now.
And you know, Arindam, obviously keeping a clean sheet is the ultimate goal for you and getting the 3 points on the board. But in the event there is a 1-1 draw, for example, is there a bad day in the office for you?
Yeah. There can be a bad day in the office, you know, even if I have not conceded any goal, but made a lot of wrong decisions, or maybe I have conceded 2 goals, you know, but I have not made any wrong decisions, you know. So it can be either way. Like, I can give you an example. Last year, Obeche scored a goal against me. Mumbai scored a goal, 1-touch goal after, I think Hugo passed the ball to him. I watched that clip at least 30-40 times, not 50, 30-40 times over. After the game for next 5-6 days, but I couldn't find what I should do, you know, what I could have done better to save the goal. So I couldn't find anything I could have done to stop that goal. Only one thing I could have done, probably ask Pritham to stay a little wide and stay with Obeche, but he had to cover this guy too. So these are small details. So sometimes you concede goals, but you don't know what to do. There's those sweet goals which you can't really save, or sometimes you have not conceded any goals, but you have made a lot of wrong decisions, you know, which probably the audience can't see with naked eye, but the coaches know, and you know when you have done those mistakes, those commitments, those commits, you know. So it's about satisfaction, and that you get only with right decisions. But yeah, obviously you don't make a lot of right decisions, but you don't concede a goal eventually. It gives you confidence, but inside you, you have the satisfaction only. You make all the right decisions in a game, even if you have conceded 1-0 or 2-0, or you have won the game and you have not made any save, but you have made some right decisions. So that satisfaction comes from only right decisions.
Yeah, I think you're Mr. Clean Sheet at this moment. Last year, you had a fantastic season, Mr. Clean Sheet. But I think that the high and the rush of a clean sheet must be just as equal to scoring a goal, right, for a striker. Would you say that's how you would equate it for a goalkeeper to have a clean sheet at the end of the day?
See, to be honest, when I started playing football, no one used to bother about clean sheet in 2006 and all. And I don't take these things too seriously. That's what, as I said, my focus is to make right decisions, you know, in a game and try and be consistent. And so that's what I focus on. And eventually, if there's clean sheet, obviously it feels good when I read in social media, especially nowadays in this Instagram and Facebook days, when I read that, okay, I got one more clean sheet, or 10 clean sheet, 12 clean sheet. It feels good to read that. But what gives me that happiness and that the joy is right decisions, you know, games after games, games after games. So that's what gives me the pleasure and the joy. So I focus on that. But then obviously when I read about clean sheet, it feels good. But when I started playing football, there was no clean sheet. There were only right decisions. So I'm still with that, you know. I get the joy with right decisions, a lot of right decisions in a game, throughout the games. Yeah.
And who did you look up to growing up? Was there some particular keeper that you really looked up to and idolized growing up?
There was a keeper called John Ekka where I grew up in my neighborhood. So he was my senior. He trained me a lot. And I used to like him a lot as a goalkeeper. Then I grew up watching Subrata Pal. Obviously, he was playing for Mohun Bagan. I used to watch him. I watched a lot of Sandeep Nandi games, you know, as a kid when I was in Tata Football Academy, at least. I knew I was going to be a professional football that time. So I was following a lot of professional football. So I saw Sandeep Nandi, Subrata Pal, Subhashish Roy Chaudhary. I have grown up watching them as when I was planning to be a professional footballer and I was training to be a professional footballer. But as an amateur, I used to watch John Ekka a lot. I used to trade with him back in our village days in the neighborhood. So yeah, these are the four goalkeepers I really grew up watching in our country. Yeah.
And globally, who would that be?
Yeah, Iker Casillas, Buffon and Oliver Kahn, I used to adore them. I still remember look for videos of them in YouTube and was, you know, making saves or those saves and training videos. We used to search for them and then we used to try and do it. Training with Churchill, you know, back in the day as young keepers, we used to try and do those trainings on our training pitch after the team training sessions. So yeah, I used to follow a lot of Buffon, Casillas and Oliver Kahn.
Have you had a chance to meet any of them or get close to any of them?
I met Oliver Kahn in Calcutta when he came for his last game, retirement game in Calcutta. I met him in Calcutta. That was right before the first Asia Cup. So I did my shoulder, my right shoulder. So I had to come back to Calcutta, I think 10 days or 15 days before the Asia Cup started in Qatar. So that's when the match happened in Calcutta, Bayern Munich. Mohun Bagan, yeah. I think I was in the stadium. I went to see Oliver Kahn. So I went to the stadium 1.5 hours before the game. I saw him warming up. I saw his warm up. And then after the game, I happened to see him from very close. I didn't go and meet him as such, but I saw him from very close. And that was enough for me as a kid. You know, I was starstruck. I was just standing there and looking at him. His aura, his personality is different. So yeah, I only was lucky enough to meet Oliver Kahn from little close and see him, not really meet him, but I didn't get a chance to meet before Casillas.
Did anything that you picked up from his warm-up routine? Did you pick up anything from what you saw?
What I saw, the quality is different. The kicking, you know, all were right. The gripping, he didn't lose one ball. And then after the warm-up got over, I still remember he punched a ball with someone. The coach was kicking him the ball because he caught all the ball, I think 10-12, when the warm-up was over. The last ball, when the coach kicked, he just punched the ball casually and the ball came in, the ball was bouncing on the half pitch, you know, the half mark line from 6 yards. And I'm not exaggerating, you know, I'm not exaggerating. The ball bounced there in half pitch and it's Salt Lake Stadium we are talking about. So I was like, okay, this guy is a beast. So that's what I remember, the warm-up. And I was just too starstruck to follow anything. I was just looking at him. I didn't bother to see anyone else. I was just focusing on Oliver Kahn. And that thing, I remember he punched that last ball and bounced in the halfway line. So that I remember. That's all I remember because I was too starstruck.
Did you ever try that out in training? Did you try reaching the halfway line with the punch?
No. I didn't try because I didn't want to embarrass myself. I didn't try that.
But that was, I think, I mean, unfortunately that you had an injury, but fortunately you got to see, I mean, probably that's a small small reward, or rather a small, how do you put it?
I was actually very disappointed when I came back from Asia Cup because I was doing good in the camp and we were there for months, and finally it's right before the Asia Cup I got injured in my shoulders. So I had to come back. It was sad as a kid because I was what, 23 that time, but I had to come back. But then yeah, I got to see Oliver Kahn and I got operated and started my rehab, and I think I had a good season after the pitch also.
Crazy. I can't believe that you got to see Oliver Kahn from so close. I've grown up seeing Oliver Kahn too on TV. I was always so enamored by the way he kept. But I mean, it's great that you got to see your hero in flesh. Awesome.
Lucky enough as a boy.
Absolutely. And looking ahead from the season, what are your thoughts? Sorry, you were saying?
No, I said thanks. Yeah, I was lucky enough. Yeah, as a growing up young goalkeeper, it was very good, motivating to see Oliver Kahn from so close. Even though the police and all, everyone was pushing, but I kept pushing them back and I had to see Oliver Kahn. So I'm happy.
Did they know who you were? Did the policemen know that you were an India keeper?
They couldn't manage the crowd because of Oliver Kahn. It's okay. They knew who I am. That's the reason I got to go so close. Otherwise, it's impossible, you know, someone walks in from the gallery and goes so close to Oliver Kahn. They knew who I am, but the police, they were outnumbered because of Oliver Kahn, the huge crowd trying to have a glance of him. But still, I managed my way in, yeah.
Man, that was some experience. Who tell us about yourself away from the football pitch. I'm sure on the pitch we've seen you're ferocious, got the loudest voice in the pitch at any point of time. And I think luckily last year, we didn't have crowds. I mean, unfortunately, we didn't have crowds. But lucky for us, we could hear you scream on the mic. We could hear what you were saying. So tell us who you are away from the pitch. I mean, we've seen you lion-hearted on the pitch. Away from the pitch, is that, are you still all aggressive and, you know, brute off the pitch as well?
Yeah, a lot of people don't know this about me, that I'm a completely different guy off the pitch. You know, I'm a completely different guy. I don't talk too much. I don't talk loud, and I'm very respectful of that. But on the pitch, I'm a different guy, you know. Probably next year now, when you see the league starts, you won't believe this is the guy you spoke to, because I'll be the loudest on the pitch. I'll do whatever I have to do to make my team win, you know, and make my teammates comfortable. You know, I'll be big enough as a boy, as a person. Probably I'll be nasty also when I need to, but that's what the job requires. And that's the reason I've been this for 16 years and I'm still doing good. But off the pitch, I'm a completely different guy. A lot of people, they don't know this, but I'm not as loud and as I am on a football pitch. I'm not so aggressive at all, like how I am on a football pitch. So I'm a completely different character off the pitch and off and on the pitch, you know.
So tell us a little about what Arindam likes to do away from the grass and the football pitch. What is it that interests you away from football?
I talk to my family a lot. I play a little bit of PlayStation. I sleep a lot. I work out in the evening. So I have that daily regime which I follow. I mean, it's every day. Every day I follow the same thing. After training, I have to sleep. I have to hydrate. I watch movies, a lot of movies, and that little bit of PlayStation. And my friends, everyone is in my room half the time. Whenever you'll call, you'll see at least 3-4 guys are in my room. We are chilling in the evening, or we are planning to do a workout in the evening together. So it's always like that. My room is always crowded and with teammates. Either I'm sleeping, watching a movie, or planning a workout, working out, or my friends are there in my room and chilling. I have a coffee machine, so you know, everyone is coming and then having coffee, having a chill together or sitting by the pool. So I enjoy the time, you know, with the team. And I'm actually, honestly, I don't know about a lot of other players, but I enjoy being in the bubble, you know, getting to spend a lot of time with football. It's good.
Are you a coffee aficionado? You like a lot of coffee?
A lot, yeah. Coffee, but I don't like milk coffee. Black coffee, Americano, espressos, yeah. I like coffee a lot. I can't do without coffee if you can rather.
How many cups do you have before a match?
Before a match, one double shot. That's all. I'm generally a little hyper on the game, so I can't have too many coffees. Probably I'll get a red card every game, you know, if I have maybe more than one cup of coffee.
I mean, I have coffee so before my workout, so I know the push that it gives you. Almost when you have that adrenaline rush, caffeine rush, but I can imagine before a game you need more than just one shot.
You can imagine two double shots on a football match. I'll probably get red card every game, you know.
Like, what kind of movies you watch? What kind of music you listen to? Do you read a lot of books or do you just like to watch movies?
I don't read a lot of books because I still have that habit from my school days. I always start sleep, especially when I have to sleep, fall asleep, I have to read something otherwise. But music, again, yeah, it depends on my mood, what I'm doing. If I'm working out, I'm just chilling after the game in my room. So I watch from reggae to rock, to classical rock, to sitar and ghazals, you know, the normal, the current Bengali songs, the Hindi romantic. It all depends on my mood, what I'm feeling. And the same goes with movies, you know. Even there are times I like the dubbing movie from South. I watch them too, and I watch the English one, the latest one. I watch a lot of series also. So saying that, I enjoy everything depends on my mood, you know. So I literally listen and watch any and everything. Yeah.
What's your number one go-to song? If I had to ask you for a good moment, for a good memory, you're feeling good, you're feeling energetic, you're feeling pumped. What's your, like, maybe like a pre-match workout, maybe like a pre-match song? Do you have like one dedicated song?
All those Punjabi music. I have a playlist of Punjabi. A few fast Bengali songs also, a few fast English also. But mostly I stick to the Punjabi numbers before the game and during the workout. So I have a playlist of songs which I, a few of them are old, but it works for me. So Punjabi numbers, I listen a little more than all the other songs. But yeah, I have a list for specific timings, you know, for during the games or pre-game, that Punjabi list, all the fast music. So I listen to them. Yeah. I think that goes with everyone.
Yeah, yeah.
Because that is all the fast Punjabi songs, especially in our country, even being from South or North or Punjab or Gujarat or Calcutta, I think everyone listens to a lot of Punjabi tunes before the game. Yeah.
I remember I had gone to Dubai to cover the Asian Cup 2019, and after we beat, after we won the first game against Thailand, so we were in the mix zone waiting for the team to come out, and I will never forget how loud the music was. Like, we were about 10 feet away. I think Sandesh was the DJ that night. The number of Punjabi songs, we were dancing in the mix zone. It was that loud. So I'll never forget the fact that I think Punjabi music is just the way to go, right? No matter where you're from. If you're on the team, it's the one thing that unites everyone at any point of time.
Yeah, I think you're right. In our country, I think everyone enjoys Punjabi music. You know, all the footballers, from wherever you are, but Punjabi tunes, you know the lyrics. You don't know the language, but you know the lyrics and you're actually enjoying the Punjabi music. So that's where Punjabi music works better in our country, I think, for footballers.
Even the foreigners have grown quite fond of it, right? Quite a few foreigners as well jive a lot, the Punjabi songs.
And last year, the Spanish players, they almost learned the lyrics. I think if we had a longer league, they would have learned the lyrics of the Punjabi, few of the famous Punjabi tunes. Roy knew pretty well. Willie knew a few of the songs. He used to ask us to play, okay, bro, play that one, that Punjabi one, that number, and like that. So, yeah, Punjabi is something all the footballers in India, they like and they fell in love with. Yeah.
If I had to put you in the spot and ask you to name one song that is your go-to song, would you be able to do that?
That song grew up as a kid listening to, it's a Punjabi number, I think it's JZB. I don't remember the lyrics, but I still listen to it. And you know, when I put that song in my speaker, everyone enjoys the Punjabis. They know the song and they wonder how you know the song, but they don't know. When I was in TFA, I used to listen to that song because my roommate was a Punjabi. So yeah, Jaise Bhi, I don't, it's a very famous song, you know. But,
is it Dil Lutiya by any chance?
Yeah.
I love that song.
My Football Academy days, from that time, I listened to that song. I still have it in my playlist and in the favorites, and we listen to it. Yeah. And the Punjabis, all the, my Balwant and Sena, and last year, a lot of Punjabi players we had, Manveer and all, they used to wonder, Paji, ye gana, aap, ab, kahan se mila aapko? Like, bro, I know more Punjabi songs than you know, dude. So, that's what Jazzy B. That means that song is one of my favorites in Punjabi.
Awesome.
Jeene Mera Dil.
Yeah, that song is still a rage. I still rage. I think 2004 ka gana hai. Well, when I was like, yeah, I was 10 or 11 years old. But
I was in TFA. Yeah, I got convocated in 2006. So 2004, I joined Tara Football Academy. That's the time. Yeah. True.
Crazy. And FIFA, of course, you said you play a bit of PlayStation. I'm sure FIFA is one of the games you play. Anything other than that?
No. Otherwise, I try and avoid this because I have to sleep and I have to recover well because if I get addicted to it. Now, there's the new thing, PUBG, I think it's banned now. So, purposely, I never, played that game because I know I'll get addicted. I've seen players, after the game, after training, they'll sit, especially Jayesh, he'll always be on PUBG. And Ankit Mukherjee, they're like, so once Ankit came home during the off season, I was sleeping in my room and Ankit was in the common area. He connected the phone, I don't know how, to the home theater, and he was talking to Jayesh at 3 o'clock in the morning. And I went to the loo and I suddenly got up with the boom, 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 and that the bomb, the bullets, and all. I was like, what's happening? Am I dreaming? Yeah, what's happening? 3:30 in the morning. And they were playing PUBG, and Ankit being home and Jayesh is in Calcutta and they're talking to Uskomar, me aara piche Uskomar, like, something is wrong at home. Then I'll, Ankit, what are you doing? Do at least play in the phone. I was about to get a heart attack. So that's why I told myself, I'm not going to play this game. I'm never going to play this game because I'm senior now. I have to rest well. And also I stayed away from PlayStation and I don't play a lot of FIFA as well now. I don't want to get addicted to it.
So what is the most used app on your phone?
I think
WhatsApp doesn't.
Tata Luxury. Tata. I have to. So you know what? I'll tell you this. I delete that app every month, maybe twice or thrice, and I'll delete the app. Then again, I have to install the app. Yeah. So then after Luxury, I think WhatsApp, Facebook, Instagram, and all that. Yeah. And Ludo. I play a lot of Ludo. Yeah. That is one thing. See, I'm addicted to Ludo. So I'll wake up, I'll play one round of Ludo online, then I'll, if I have the time, if I don't have training in the morning, so I'll wake up, I'll, on the bed only, I'll play Ludo online, then I'll start my day. So I that's the reason I try stay away from this video game and all that. I'm already addicted to Ludo. I just remembered.
Two things. One, I have never heard of anybody I've interviewed so far who said Tata Click is the number one used app on their phone. Congratulations, that's very unique.
Half the time, I don't buy anything, but I'll keep things in the cart and then I'll watch if there's any discount. Oh no, that's gone. Oh, the last size is left, my 10. I can't wait for discount, so I have to pick it. So I do all this with Tata. Then again, one day I'll get fed up. I spent a lot of money. I'll uninstall the app. Then again, 3 days, yaar, maza nahi aa raha, I'll install that app. Okay. What am I doing, dude? So it's crazy.
And what Ludo do you guys play amongst yourselves? Do you have like a room of your own? Jampe tumna khelte ho?
Online also, and we play with the friends also, teammates, but with teammates you need an iPad. The phone it's not that enjoying, but with iPad we play. Last year we used to play a lot of Ludo with iPad. I think Pritam had an iPad, I don't have an iPad. So yeah, whenever in the evening we used to sit with chai and Ludo, 2-3 rounds of Ludo, and then we'll fight and then we'll like, why you are helping him, you're not helping me, you're helping him, and all that thing. And online, yeah, we play both.
I don't know. You can get an iPad from Tata Click.
You're not helping me.
The This is such an amazing chat. Anshi, thank you so much for your time. I just want to have a last question, which I think everybody would want to know. What are your thoughts and expectations ahead of this upcoming season? And what are your personal goals or targets that you've set for yourself?
Personal targets are, I want to win every game. And I want to win every battle. I want to qualify for the knockout rounds at least. And then from there, how we can go to the final. And that's my personal target. And try and win the trophy and the league, obviously, to finish with. And as a team, we are trying to gel and see how far we can go. But again, as a team, we players have already discussed that we have to go to the knockout rounds anyhow and win the both the derbies. You know, being from the Calcutta team, you know, we know the importance of derby. So we have to focus on the derby, and also we have to qualify for the knockout round. But again, a coach has given us targets, and coach has told us already that we have to go game by game, and we have to have a good start because it's not a very long league; it's just 20 games league. So it's very important to have a good start, especially being a new team. So we'll focus on that a lot. The final goal is to qualify for the semi final and see how far we can go from there and try and win it eventually.
Absolutely. Have you had any brief chats with Leslie, the new goalkeeping coach? He's coached, I think, at Chelsea, a lot of big keepers he's worked with. Have you had a few chats? What have those conversations been? Yeah.
We talk every day, you know. We talk every day. Our phone coach checks on me. What's happening? Are you eating well? Are you working out? Are you doing the program? You're not putting on weight and all. He takes care of all the minute details for us goalkeepers, which really helps a lot. And yeah, we are training well, and he gives us those small information in terms of positioning and, you know, the importance of rest and body shape and how to get up for a second ball. All the small details he's helping us with, which is very important because I know he has done that with all the big goalkeepers in England. So and we are getting to share experience with him, which is I'm sure it's going to help us. So yeah, we're having a good time with Leslie coach here.
I see you have a tattoo on your right bicep. What does it say?
Only God can judge me.
Oh wow, nice.
I thought I'll even God is confused, but I changed my mind and I wrote one life, one child. So but I have both my arms.